Hello YouTube, in this hypertrophy series I'm going to talk about pyramid sets, drop sets and finishes. And you might be wondering why I'm pairing these together, why they're grouped in the same video. The reason why is because they represent, in my opinion, subpar ways to accumulate tonnage. And the reason is that these are sets, these are types of sets that are going to force you to work in a window of intensity that is not going to be super relevant. And therefore, I want to put them in exergue and compare them to a different type of set that I personally prefer because it's going to allow you to accumulate a lot of quality tonnage. So first off, let's define the terms I'm going to be using. I call finisher anything that you do at the very end of your set for a certain body part or movement just to completely exhaust the muscle and just be done with it. It's a way to wrap it up. And that's actually my preferred method out of the three I'm presenting. The drop set method is you do a set with a certain weight, then you strip and you do another set. There are different types of drop sets, but that's pretty much the idea. You reach muscular failure and then you're going to give yourself zero time to recover. You're going to go into another set with a lower weight to reach muscular failure again. And the last one, the pyramid set, there's two types. There's the partial pyramid set, or you just ramp up to a top set with a top weight, and there is a complete pyramid set where you're actually going to tempo down on the other side. So let's start with the pyramid set. I am personally a big advocate of the partial pyramid set because to me that's what makes the most sense in terms of hypertrophy. You warm up, and the best way to warm up a lift is just to do the lift with less weight until you get to your top set, which is defined by your intensity, the number of reps you want to do for that certain day, and you're going to define the amount of top sets too. I have always found that a number that is going to be equated between 1 and 3 is going to be the most relevant, because when you start doing 4, 5, 6, you're going to enter a realm where sandbagging becomes extremely prevalent. For example, a 5x5 has a lot of sandbagging. And so for me, if you're talking top sets and top intensity for strength work, you should stay low. There is no point in set multiplication at this point. That comes later. And that is what I do in my training too. I'm going to ramp up and then I do 1 to 3 sets of heavy weight where I really push the bill. And I use the rep in the tank method as I've described in a previous hypertrophy video. So that's what I do. That's what I like. Now, some people like to do the complete pyramid. They're going to do their top set. Then they're going to strip the weight and they're going to do another set or another two sets. The reason why I'm not a fan of this method is that when you look at it, you're going to end up thinking that the sets that come afterwards are just as valuable as the ones that came before. And that's not the case. You have to accept the fact that since they're done in a lower absolute intensity window, they're not as interesting in terms of quality tonnage. That being said, because they come after the top sets in terms of relative intensity, they are very interesting because it's still volume. So I'm not saying that it's completely useless. I am just saying that these are not going to be as prolific for your progression that you might think, but they're still valuable. And in a sense, doing the full pyramid really equates to back off sets when you think about it. And that's also my issue with it. If you're just going to do back off sets, say you're doing back off sets, because that's going to allow you to control the volume better. When you do pyramid sets and you tempo down, too many people don't take that into consideration and they don't program it properly. And that's important because if you are very selective with your top set and the weight selection and the rep range, then it also means that whatever continuation of that, when you lower the weight, needs to be done in the same fashion. You can't just randomly decide to strip 25 pounds and do a random amount of reps. It needs to be calculated. It needs to be programmed. Because if you're going to tell me that these sets that come afterwards actually are helping you grow, well, then they should be in a relevant intensity window. And there cannot be a relevant intensity if you don't calculate it. So I encourage you to think of them as back-off sets and potentially do them again, in a set multiplication scheme, meaning you're not going to just keep stripping the weight. You're going to pyramid up, do your top set, and then you're going to pyramid down to a select weight, 1, while you're not going to drop any further, and you're going to do 2 to 3 sets. That's the best way to do back off sets. I think that if you end up doing 3 sets of the top weight and then three sets where you keep stripping each set, that's a waste of time. It ends up being junk volume because in terms of absolute intensity, it's too low and it's not really challenging your baseline at this point. So that needs to be avoided. And just for the growing up, the face up side of the pyramid, I know that most people don't do that, but I just want to make sure that no one on this channel is going to make the mistake. You do the same exact thing on this side of the pyramid. You're not going to have your three top sets that have different weights. I am adamantly and vehemently against that practice. A top set has a fixated weight. And that also goes for the other side of the pyramid as well, because I think that if you only do one top set, like all the time, and you never cycle the set selection, and then you immediately temper down, you're sort of stealing yourself some gains. You should strive to be able to do three sets of relatively high reps with a high weight. It's always going to be better than just being able to have one meek set, then you have to temper down. Unless you're really pushing for intensity and progression on that specific set, but it cannot be a scheme that is repeated all the time. So that's for the pyramid. For the drop set, drop sets are worse in my opinion because the mindset of the drop set is, since I am in a constant state of muscular failure, then that must mean that I'm going to grow. That's not necessarily true. I've explained that in the past. The issues of mechanical failure make it so that your inability to keep cranking out reps might not be correlated with any relevant muscle fiber damage. It's just that your baseline is taxed in the moment. But if you gave time for your baseline to recover, you would be able to perform again. What needs to happen is the performance of the reps need to be taken into account when it comes to intensity windows. And the issue is that the drop set just completely throws that out of the window. So it's not a bad scheme, but it cannot be a main scheme. And that's sort of the main idea behind those three topics I'm presenting in this hypertrophy series. You can use them, I'm not saying don't use them, but don't use them for your main scheme of progression. Use fixated or evolving set ranges for top sets and use what I'm presenting today as a way to complete it, right? So for example, as I explained for the back of set, it's fine with the pyramid. For the drop set, I think that once you're done with your third set, let's say you do three heavy sets, you're done with your third set, now the progression is taken care of. If you want additional volume and pump and you want to go to failure, now you can add a drop set to the last set. Now that makes sense. But if you did three heavy sets and you start doing a drop set after the first heavy set, you're stealing yourself of your ability to perform on the other two sets. And these are the reps that count because they are high intensity. So don't do that. Be careful with that. There's a lot of programs that get a ton of their volume from the drop set. Understand that, as I explained when I introduced the concept, just because they're hard reps doesn't mean that they make you grow. It's just that you're tired, your muscles are full of lactic acid. So it's always better to have a set where you're entering it fresh and you're able to fully express your strength than one where you're pre-fatigued, because in reality, pre-fatigue prevents you from being performant. And the last one, and the one that I started by saying that it's the one I like the most, is the finisher. And the reason why I like it so much is because it's really resembling the description of the drop set that I just made to you, the one that actually works. For me, a finisher is something that I'm going to do at the end of a movement or a muscle when I know that on the same day, I'm not going to recruit that muscle group anymore, and I'm just going to trash it. So for example, at the end of deadlift day or low body day, I'm going to do shrugs. I'm going to put 275 on the bar and shrug as much as I can. Then I'll do some pull-ups, shrug again, drop to 225, shrug again. It's simple, it's easy, it doesn't take any time, it doesn't stall from progression, but it's still volume. And as I explained before, since you're doing these reps at the end of the workout, you're super deep in the baseline, your ability to recover is low, so the relative intensity of these, even though that's technically easy weight, it's still going to tax you because the muscle is already really tired, and that's great, that's what you want. And you can apply that to any muscle group. Chest, for example, you had a heavy chest day, throw in two sets of push-ups at the end. It doesn't cost anything. It might help with recovery. It might help with injury prevention. Now, are the gains you're going to get from these massive? No, of course not, because it's, by definition, since they're just finishers, they're just there to finish. So it's the nice little polish that you add at the end. But the good thing with these is they can help. They can help with sensation to get a nice pump or a nice feeling at the end of the workout. And at the end of the day, it's also a way to wrap the workout on a positive note, because you're going to end up with something that's not going to really get you to failure. It's not going to really challenge you mentally or psychologically, and it might help you attack the next training day in a positive mindset. So I encourage you to do that. The finisher is an excellent aspect of the training that needs to be implemented, because as I said, it costs nothing even in terms of recovery. But because it doesn't cost anything in terms of recovery, it also means that you don't get much gain from that. The only thing you need to avoid is, don't let a finisher become the main wielder of gains and tonnage in your program, because it lacks the ability to do so. So just be careful with that. In total, these three practices are valuable for hypertrophy, but as I said, they cannot be the main driver because they lack the ability to do so. As I explained, there's too many issues with programming these, and therefore any program that has them as, you know, their main king is a bad program. So that's going to be that for this video. Thank you for watching. Have a good day.